Matthew 3:10, Luke 3:9. And now also the axe. After having stripped hypocrites of the covering of a vain confidence, John announces the approaching judgment of God. He had formerly said that, though they were rejected, God would not want a people, and he now adds, that God is just about to drive out unworthy persons from the church, as barren trees are wont to be cut down. His statement amounts to this, that God has already displayed his power for purifying the church. The grace of God is never manifested for the salvation of the godly, till his judgment first appears for the destruction of the world, and for two reasons, because God then separates his own people from the reprobate, and because his wrath is kindled anew by the ingratitude of the world. So that we have no reason to wonder, if the preaching of the gospel and the coming of Christ laid the axe for cutting down barren trees, or if the same causes daily advance the wrath of God against the wicked. Luke 3:10 And the multitudes asked him. A true feeling of repentance produces in the mind of the poor sinner an eager desire to know what is the will or command of God. John's reply explains, in a few words, the fruits worthy of repentance, for the world is always desirous to acquit itself of its duty to God by performing ceremonies, and there is nothing to which we are more prone than to offer to God pretended worship, whenever he calls us to repentance. But what fruits does the Baptist here recommend? The duties of charity, and of the second table of the law, not that God disregards the outward profession of godliness, and of his worship, but that this is a surer mark of distinction, and less frequently leads to mistakes. For hypocrites labor strenuously to prove themselves worshippers of God by the performance of ceremonies, paying no regard, however, to true righteousness, for they are either cruel to their neighbors, or addicted to falsehood and dishonesty. It was therefore necessary to subject them to a more homely examination, if they are just in their dealings with men, if they relieve the poor, if they are generous to the wretched, if they give liberally what the Lord has bestowed upon them. This is the reason why our Lord pronounces judgment, mercy, and faith, to be the weightier matters of the law, Matthew 23:23, and Scripture everywhere recommends justice and judgment. We must particularly observe, that the duties of charity are here mentioned, not because they are of higher value than the worship of God, but because they testify the piety of men, so as to detect the hypocrisy of those who boast with the mouth what is far distant from the heart. But it is asked, did John lay this injunction, in a literal sense, on all whom he was preparing to be Christ's disciples, that they should not have two coats? We must observe, first, that this is the figure of speech which is called a synecdoche, for under one example it comprehends a general rule. Hence it follows, that we must draw from it a meaning, which corresponds to the law of charity, as it is laid down by God, and that law is, that each person should give out of his abundance to supply the wants of the poor. God does not extort a tax, to be paid grudgingly or of necessity by those who, but for that necessity, would have chosen not to pay it, for the Lord loveth a willing and cheerful giver, 2 Corinthians 9-7. I make this observation, because it is of great consequence for men to be convinced, that the portion of their wealth which they bestow in this manner is a sacrifice pleasing and of good savor to God, that with such sacrifices God is well pleased, Hebrews 13:16. Those who lay it down as a law, that no man must have any property of his own, not only make consciences to tremble, but overwhelm them with despair. With fanatics of this sort, who obstinately adhere to the literal meaning, it is not necessary that we should spend much time in refutation. If we are not allowed to have two coats, the same rule will apply to dishes, to salt cellars, to shirts, and, in short, to all the furniture of a house. But the context makes it evident, that nothing was farther from John's intention than to overthrow the order of a state. Hence we infer, that all that he enjoined on the rich was, that they should bestow on the poor, according to their own ability, what their necessity required. Consider to what extent the necessaries of life, which you enjoy abundantly, are wanted by your neighbors, that your abundance may be a supply for their want, 2 Corinthians 8:14. But the more liberty that God allows us, we ought to be the more careful not to allow ourselves undue liberty. Let the necessity of our brethren affect us powerfully, and let the bounty of God, which is in our hands, stimulate us to acts of kindness and generosity. Luke 3:12. And the publicans also came. The publicans are not only exhorted, in general terms, to repent, but the duties peculiar to their calling are demanded, for we know that, besides the general rule of the law, each person ought to consider what is required by the nature of the employment to which he has been called. All Christians, without distinction, are taught of God to love one another, 1 Thessalonians 4:9, but then there follow particular duties, which a teacher, for example, is bound to perform towards the church, a magistrate or prince towards the people, and the people, on the other hand, towards the magistrate, a husband towards his wife, and a wife towards her husband, and finally, children and parents toward each other. The publicans, viewed as a class, were covetous, rapacious, and cruel, and often oppressed the people by unjust exactions. In consequence of this, the Baptist reproved them for those offenses, with which that class was, for the most part, chargeable, when he commands them not to go beyond moderation in exacting tribute. At the same time, we draw this inference, that it is quite as lawful for a Christian man to receive or levy taxes, as for a magistrate to impose them. In the same way we must judge about war. John does not order the soldiers to throw away their arms, and to relinquish their oath, but he forbids them to pillage the wretched people under the pretense of their duty as soldiers, to bring false accusations against the innocent, and to be guilty of extortions, all of which crimes the greater part of them were accustomed to practice. These words obviously contain an approbation of civil government. It is a piece of idle sophistry to say, that John's hearers were ignorant people, and that he gave them nothing more than elementary instructions, which fell very far short of Christian perfection. John's office was, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord, Luke 1:17, and there is no doubt that it was entirely and faithfully performed. Those men are guilty of calumny and sacrilege, who slander the gospel, by declaring it to be opposed to human governments, as if Christ destroyed what his heavenly Father sanctioned. But, without the sword, laws are dead, and legal judgments have no force or authority. Magistrates require not only an executioner, but other attendants, among whom are the military, without whose assistance and agency it is impossible to maintain peace. Still, the object must be considered. Princes must not allow themselves to sport with human blood, nor must soldiers give themselves up to cruelty, from a desire of gain, as if slaughter were their chief business, but both must be drawn to it by necessity, and by a regard to public advantage, Matthew 3:11. He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. It is asked, why did not John equally say, that it is Christ alone who washes souls with his blood? The reason is, that this very washing is performed by the power of the Spirit, and John reckoned it enough to express the whole effect of baptism by the single word Spirit. The meaning is clear, that Christ alone bestows all the grace which is figuratively represented by outward baptism, because it is he who sprinkles the conscience with his blood. It is he also who mortifies the old man, and bestows the Spirit of regeneration. The word fire is added as an epithet, and is applied to the Spirit, because he takes away our pollutions, as fire purifies gold. In the same manner, he is metaphorically called water in another passage, John 3-5. 12. Whose winnowing fan is in his hand. In the former verse, John preached concerning the grace of Christ, that the Jews might yield themselves to him to be renewed. Now he discourses of judgment, that he may strike despisers with terror. As there are always many hypocrites who proudly reject the grace of Christ offered to them, it is also necessary to denounce the judgment that awaits them. For this reason John here describes Christ as a severe judge against unbelievers. And this is an order which must be observed by us in teaching, that hypocrites may know, that their rejection of Christ will not go unpunished. They will thus be roused from their lethargy, and begin to dread him as an avenger, whom they despised as the author of salvation. I have no doubt, that John intended also to show what Christ accomplishes by means of his gospel. The preaching of the gospel, then, is the winnowing fan before the Lord sifts us. The whole world is involved in confusion, everyone flatters himself, and the good are mixed with the bad. In short, it is only necessary that the chaff be blown. But when Christ comes forward with his gospels, when he reproves the consciences and summons them to the tribunal of God, the chaff is sifted out. 286, which formerly occupied a great part of the thrashing floor. It is true that, in the case of individuals, the gospel effects a separation from the chaff, but in this passage, John compares the reprobate to chaff, and believers to wheat. The thrashing floor accordingly denotes, not the world, as some people imagine, but the church, for we must attend to the class of persons whom John addresses. The mere title filled the Jews with pride, 287, but John tells them that it is foolish in them to be proud of it, because they hold but a temporary place in the church of God, from which they are soon to be thrown out, like chaff from the thrashing floor. In this way, he gives a rapid glance at the corrupt state in which the church then was, for it was covered with husks, and straws, and other rubbish, but would soon be cleansed by the strong breeze of the gospel. But how is Christ said to separate the chaff from the wheat, when he can find nothing in men but mere chaff? The answer is easy. The elect are formed into wheat, and are then separated from the chaff, and collected into the granary. He will thoroughly cleanse his thrashing floor. This work was begun by Christ, and is daily going forward, but the full accomplishment of it will not be seen till the last day. This is the reason why John draws our attention to the subject. But let us remember, that believers even now enter, by hope, into the granary of God, in which they will actually have their everlasting abode, while the reprobate experience, in their convictions of guilt, the heat of that fire, the actual burning of which they will feel at the last day. Many persons, I am aware, have entered into ingenious debates about the eternal fire, by which the wicked will be tormented after the judgment. But we may conclude from many passages of Scripture, that it is a metaphorical expression. For, if we must believe that it is real, or what they call material fire, we must also believe that the brimstone and the fan are material, both of them being mentioned by Isaiah. For Tophet is ordained of old, the pile thereof is fire and much wood, the breath of the Lord, like a stream of brimstone, doth kindle it, Isaiah 30 hours 33 minutes. We must explain the fire in the same manner as the worm, Mark 9:44, 46, 48, and if it is universally agreed that the worm is a metaphorical term, we must form the same opinion as to the fire. Let us lay aside the speculations, by which foolish men weary themselves to no purpose, and satisfy ourselves with believing, that these forms of speech denote, in a manner suited to our feeble capacity, a dreadful torment, which no man can now comprehend, and no language can express.